Crunchyroll, what are you doing? What are you doing? It's Mayweather versus McGregor night, and Crunchyroll decides to drop the ball. Of course there was going to be high traffic. Weren't you prepping for this? Hello? See, this is part of the reason for why people watch illegal stuff, man. This is not good. So if the review is late, this is why. It's very frustrating. It should be unacceptable, especially for a service that, you know, you have to pay for.
I think 110 just took the cake. I'm going to say it's really hard to be objective right now because the episode just ended and that was something else. That was absolutely tremendous. So it's hard to be objective, but I'm going to say it's probably the best episode of Super thus far. That final sequence with Goku going all out against Jiren is probably one of the best animated exchanges battle-wise and action-wise and just hype-wise that I've seen in a very long time. I think it's definitely Goku's best fight, best combat exchange to date in the Super anime. All right, not including the movies. If you take away the movies, I think this is it, which is actually kind of funny considering the fact that he technically loses the exchange. I mean, because Jiren is just a monster. He is unstoppable. He remains in base throughout most of it, and by the end, he only activates his red aura after Goku kind of pushes him to do so after activating his new mode.
There's so many different aspects to this fight that just made me like it so much. The first stare down in the beginning, and then you hear the trumpets, and then Goku starts scaling Jiren. At first he goes Super Saiyan, tries a couple of hits, doesn't do anything. Then he goes Super Saiyan 2, doesn't do anything. Goes Super Saiyan God, alright? And then he manages to force him to stop his hit with a finger, so at least he gets him to move. Just, Krillin actually did a really good analysis throughout this whole thing. I really appreciated that. And then, but then he's like, no, I can't do anything with this. So he goes Super Saiyan Blue, and that's where he begins to sort of like, you know, the fight intensifies, and he does push Jiren through a couple of blocks of rubble and stuff. But then Jiren ups his speed and completely blitzes Goku, and it's like he treats him like a ragdoll by grabbing him and just like throwing him around. So then like Goku's like, oh crap, well it's Super Saiyan Blue plus Kaioken. This one part where Krillin is like, oh my gosh, like, you know, Goku, at this point, he should be able to use Super Saiyan Blue plus Kaioken times 20. And then Beerus is like, he's already using it. He's already using it.
Like, what is going on? This guy is a monster. He is a tank.
And he has this ability, right, where I'm assuming he has so much energy pumped up inside of him. He has so many energy reserves that he doesn't even have to move to attack Goku. Like, he just unleashes a little bit of this energy wall that he has, and Goku's like, oh.
And then Vegeta's like on the other side going like, yo, what was that? Like, I didn't even see that.
The incorporation of the music and the sound effects into that sequence was just tremendous. It was great. I loved how they showed other people's reactions to what was going on. I think that's definitely something that the previous episodes have lacked. Here it's like we get to see, like, we see the characters' live reaction, for lack of a better term. We got people in the arena and in the bleachers staring in awe, just looking at these guys, thinking like, what is going on? The Genki-Dama explodes like a nuke. I was sitting there having the exact same reaction as both Xenos. You see the after effects of everything, the music, the sound effects, all right? They play, like, you know, a lot of instrumental that was like a different version of Limit X Break, and it's just dun 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 dun. It was a very fluid and dynamic exchange, in no small part due to the great work of the animators for these specials. Man, they were not joking, you know, because last week they delivered with one half of the One Piece episode, and they did the same thing here.
Now, the special actually serves to give us more information about Ribrianne. We find out that if she wins the tournament, her wish will be that she wants to become a goddess. Now, whether that's a god of destruction or, you know, she's going to try and sort of substitute for Heles, we don't know. Heles doesn't seem to have a problem with that. But yeah, that's her goal, essentially, to become a goddess of love and, you know, friendship and all that stuff. And when it comes to Jiren, I thought it was very interesting that, well, first of all, it seemed like Vermood or Bermud, whatever, he was the one telling Jiren to hold back this entire time, because he's like, okay, now it's time to just do your business here. Now it's time for you to fight for your wish. And we don't know what that wish is, but I strongly get the impression that it has to be something noble. Because, and I think that's exactly why the spirit bomb didn't work on him. Like, the spirit bomb is intended to take down people that have malicious intent. So it just didn't work on him. I think if it had worked on him, that would have been weird. But thankfully it didn't work. And also, it is now 100% confirmed that the legends about this warrior from another universe, like this mortal that not even a god of destruction can defeat, and I guess it depends on which god of destruction we're talking about here, but that is 100% confirmed in this episode to be Jiren, and it's super interesting because it's like, at this point, if he has surpassed god of destruction level, then what do you end up wishing for after that? I don't know why, but I get the feeling that he's trying to bring back somebody that he lost, or maybe a group of people that he lost that were dear to him. Because again, he acts super noble even when he's fighting Goku. Like, when Goku's like charging up the spirit bomb, he's like, if that's your special move, I'll just stand here and wait for you to charge it up. And that speaks to him having some type of an honorable code. And also, when Rebrianne was trying to pick a fight with him, like, he just completely ignores her, knowing full well that he can just pretty much deal with her almost immediately. It's just beastly because this guy is pretty much holding back almost throughout the entire special. When the spirit bomb gets aimed at him, Weeze even says, the amount of willpower it must take for this guy to push back, to control this thing, just with his glare alone, is out of this world. To the point where everybody in the stands pretty much agrees, like, both Goku and Jiren must have had some type of special interventions. You need to be trained by a god, essentially, to obtain this level. The Genki-Dama struggle was interesting because it's literally like the anime version of a ping pong match or a volleyball game, but you're using energy to push it back. I did think it was a little bit surprising that they allowed the guys in the bleachers to donate their energy for the Genki-Dama, such as Krillin, Tenshinhan, and Roshi.
But I guess that was kind of foreshadowed when they showed that Rebrianne could receive energy to form her butterfly cocoon from one of the girls that was already eliminated. But in Goku's case, like, even Frieza donates some energy. That was very surprising.
You see snippets of him throughout the episode looking like he's, you know, planning something, and then by the end, that cliffhanger with him was great. It was a great ending to the episode. I saw that Herms on Twitter had a pretty good suggestion about what's going to happen next after that scene, because it seems like, for all intents and purposes, I think it seems like Frieza is about to kill Goku with that blast. He's about to shoot him and either kill him or eliminate him, but the suggestion from Herms is that he's actually going to heal him, giving Goku some of that energy, because he's kind of returning the favor from Namek when Goku gave Frieza some of his energy when the planet was exploding. Of course, you know, Frieza misused that opportunity, and that eventually, you know, ended up causing his death, but he's going to return the favor just because he doesn't want to owe Goku anything. And I actually made a prediction video a long time ago, and I thought that that was actually something that Frieza was going to do, but I thought that he was going to do it with Gohan, and that Gohan would awaken a new form with Frieza's energy.
And speaking of energy donation, why do you think Vegeta refused to give some of his energy to Goku to form the Genki-Dama? Is it because of his pride, you think? Or, you know, maybe he just wants to sort of like remain as full as possible in order to take down other opponents? Because he refuses to give him energy, but at the same time he has Goku's back because Rebrianne wants to sneak in like a cheap shot just to, you know, catch him from the back, and Vegeta's like, nope, can't do that, that ain't cool.
Now that I think about it, I think the reason for why the writers decided to have Vegeta not give any energy is because there's going to be a round two, a Goku versus Jiren rematch, and Goku can't get stronger by doing the exact same thing twice. So I think what's going to happen is that during that rematch, there's going to be another Genki-Dama. Goku's probably going to have to absorb it, but this time Vegeta will donate some of his energy, and that'll make it more powerful.
Now, I do have to admit that there is a little bit of fake tension in the middle of the last episode. When the Genki-Dama collapses, like, the spectators are under the impression that Goku is no more, and Zeno is about to hit Goku's face on the pad to eliminate him from the lineup. And it's like, I mean, yeah, you kind of like appreciate that for the character's reactions, like I said, especially Beerus's reaction. I don't think we've ever seen him like showcase those types of feelings for Goku. He even like shouts, "Son, Goku!" But I do think it's a little bit of fake tension for us fans, because it's like, we've seen the scans, we know the spoilers, we know a new form is coming. So it's like, okay, come on, like, let's get to it. But just the execution of Beerus's reaction to that moment, in that moment, I think it definitely makes up for it. Now, what made Goku's new form stand out, what made the form cool for me, has very little to do with the new color scheme. Even though I like silver, you know, the color scheme for new forms, like, you know, they change every time. And, you know, it's kind of like all over the place now at this point. What made this form cool, and if I'm being completely honest, is that there's a little bit of menace to it. There's a little bit of an intimidation factor that you see on screen that you're like, you're not very sure if it's all good. It feels like there's like a little bit of like malice to it. And you kind of get that feeling, especially because of the role of the silence. When he goes into that form, it's like silent, right? He's just like moving, dodging hits, just mastering this form. And it's very, very eerie. Goku has once again surpassed his limits, all right? Gone up a notch, and he's now in this new level. And it looks really cool, but there's a part of you that kind of thinks, is this a good thing for Goku? Like, is this going to lead him down the right path, considering his addiction to fight like stronger and stronger opponents, and considering the implications that, you know, basically everybody's life is on the line, depending on who wins or who loses this tournament, right? And I think this eerie feeling is further supported by the echo in his voice when he screams. It almost feels like there's a demon trapped inside of him. Kind of like back in the day when he could turn into the ape. There's a hint of that in there. That's kind of like the feeling that I got. And so the form kind of works to give him like this sort of darker characterization. And that's why I completely appreciate it and I value it. Honestly, I think it's what Super Saiyan 4 should have been.
I mean, even Krillin reiterates the fact that when Goku goes Super Saiyan, maliciousness kind of creeps inside of him. But I think this new form definitely sort of like takes that concept and just ups it up a notch. I think it's a little bit darker this time. Now, in terms of technicalities, the name of the form is Ultra Instinct, according to Beerus, and I'm gonna call it, for this video, I'm gonna call it Ultra Instinct Super Saiyan, just because I think it sounds cool, which apparently is something, it's a function that even gods have trouble mastering. So this is how big of a leap Goku made in this episode. Now, what happened here is that it's a double parter, right? There's two reasons for why this form was attained. And the first one is the Spirit Bomb, the Genki Dama. So what happened was the Genki Dama, it kind of collapsed in on itself, if you notice. And you can think like, well, how was the Genki Dama even like supposed to hurt Goku if like the Spirit Bomb is only capable of hurting people that have malicious intent? But the problem was that the Genki Dama has never been pushed to this extent, where in which two people that aren't really malicious, aren't evil, are pushing back on it to the point where it creates like so much friction, like the energy itself doesn't know what to do with itself because it's just not landing, it's not making contact with anything. So eventually it just bursts, it just explodes, it turns into a nuke. And nukes don't care whether you're a good person or a bad person, it'll just destroy you, it'll consume you. And so Goku got the short end of the stick and he's falling into this explosion, and in order to survive it, he has to break his limits once again, and that's what ended up happening. So once he broke those limits to survive, he broke out of his shell, and that energy of the Genki Dama was not wasted, because you see that in his aura, all right? But at the same time, there's another aspect to it, is the heat that is also emanating from his body, and that's because he broke his limits. Limit X break survivor! Oh my gosh, now I get it. And so now essentially what the form does for Goku is that it increases his reflexes and his adaptability exponentially, to the point where he adapts to Jiren's initial fighting style, his combat style, and then is able to just surpass that wall that Jiren had pretty much up throughout the entire tournament up until this point. He breaks through that. So, but then the form runs out, and that's a problem. And I think it's heavily implied that even if Jiren doesn't understand Goku's new form 100%, which, by the way, to be fair, not even Goku understands it 100%, but I think it's heavily implied that at least Jiren understands the mechanics of the form, and it's safe to say that he has a lot more insight to showcase before the tournament is over about how that would work and how Goku could use that to its full potential.
I thought the new ending theme was pretty nostalgic. You know, it just starts off with young Goku and, you know, kind of him growing up. And I thought it was actually a reference, I don't know if you noticed this, I thought it was very similar to the first ending of Super, where we see Goku just walking and in the background we see different places of the Dragon Ball series. He kind of just works his way up and you're like, oh wow, look at that. This is how far we've come.
And finally by the end, Hit arrives and tries to take on Jiren by himself. Vados even says that usually when opponents have just defeated another enemy, that's where they're at their most vulnerable. And then she says, turns out Jiren doesn't even have that weakness because he was able to just completely just block Hit, right? And just like very casually so. So unfortunately, even though I love Hit as a character, I do not see him winning this one. I don't think there's any way they would hype Jiren up so much to for him to be defeated by Hit at this point. I think they're just giving him something to do while Goku recoups. And if you go back and watch the preview, like you see Jiren pretty much like predicting or breaking through the time skip pretty easily. So that's unfortunate for Hit. Now, I forgot to say that I did notice that they were reusing some of the animation from the opening. They just gave, like, you know, Goku his new aura. But overall, man, like, 110, it surpassed my expectations significantly. And I know every episode can't be like this. I understand that. But I feel like if they were to aim for this type of quality, you know, if they had this type of quality in mind every time they did an episode, then oh boy, like this would just be an amazing experience week to week. And you know, like I said, I know every episode can't be this way, and it's not even about like making money. It's not even about popularity, because this show is going to make money and it's going to be popular no matter what. But it's really just about quality, and they delivered. They delivered with this. It was an amazing episode to watch. In Spanish, we say "se la bañaron." Se la bañaron con este episodio. Excelente. Sin palabras. No words. No words, even though I just spoke about it for like 17 minutes.
Guys, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the transformation and the battle sequence as much as I did, Goku versus Jiren. Please like the video if you did. If not, that's okay too. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, because I do Dragon Ball Super reviews every Saturday night.
Except when, you know, sites decide not to spend money on their servers.
And please share your thoughts about this 1 hour Dragon Ball Super special down in the comment section. Thank you. Have a good night, day, whatever it is for you. Catch you later. Bye.